Welcome to part 9 of this series. My name is Kronoslav Stifter, and in this episode we are going to talk about mainly matching color and tone between different images. Now, originally I wanted to talk about matching these three images together. If you remember from our first few episodes, I worked on this image mostly. Then I started working on this one to kind of, in the last episode, episode 8 I believe, I tried to match them together. And then lastly I did the third image, and maybe if I zoom in you'll see what I mean. So they're kind of very similar in terms of color and tone. So how to achieve all that, that's something I wanted to talk about, and that was the original plan. However, I realized that I put myself in a bit of an awkward position when I started doing this series. The thing is that these images are above average in terms of complexity when you're trying to match color and tone, mainly because we were trying to get that Gucci look, and then I think I put myself in a position where I have a bit more masking and complexity in work. So since I really wanted to show you how to match different colors together in tone, using these images to demonstrate that might be a bit confusing to some people. So in order to simplify this before we actually start working with these images, I'll use another series. And in this series we have the same model, female model, the same photographer. It's on the beach. It's just a kind of different series, and they're much easier to work with. So we'll use some of these images, namely these three images, and we're going to focus on matching the color between them using Camera Raw and Photoshop. And once you have that kind of baseline understanding, because these are easier to work with, then you'll have a solid foundation to know what I normally do. And then we can go back to our much more complex images and continue building on that knowledge, okay? And then lastly, I wanted to focus on this image because there are some things I can use in this image to show you a few tips and tricks and kind of build upon what we learned in all the previous episodes up until this point, all right? So if you haven't, please subscribe, share this with your friends. That makes me, the more people see this, the more videos I can make. And leave comments if you have any questions. Click a like button, please, and let's get started. All right, let's get started. Now, what I'll do is I'll select the three images that I showed you. And once I have my selected images, I can either click on Open in Camera Raw or just right click on them and choose Open in Camera Raw. This will make my images open up in Camera Raw, but it's too big of a window, so let me reduce that. And there we have our three images opened up inside of Camera Raw. Now we're ready to get working on these images. However, as you can see, these are raw images, unprocessed yet, and they're a bit too dark. I mean, they're a bit underexposed. So let's see what Lightroom, in this case, Camera Raw can do if I click on Auto. And it did a pretty nice job, I would say, just from the start, right? It kind of fixed all the sliders for me, so I have much more detail inside the image, the exposure is better. What I'm lacking, however, is some color in this image, something to make it more pop. Now, what I can do perhaps is go to this camera calibrations tab and choose between different camera profiles to see if one will give me better rendition of the color. And I actually prefer landscape here. I think it gives more color to begin with, but it also does some really bad stuff to the models. It just changes the way it remaps the colors, and that I don't like the skin in this one. So I'll go to standard, and I'll just play around with the slider here. I'll add a bit of more saturation. Maybe add slight touch of clarity here because I want to make those background pop a little bit. And let's see if we can add maybe a little bit more warmth to this image. I like that more. Maybe add a bit more shadow detail here, not too much. And the only thing I don't like is the fact that we have a problem with the sky, right? It's just way too bright and not really interesting. So if I go to my HSL grayscale sliders, and probably the blues, right? So if I go to luminance and blues, yeah, I can bring that sky a bit down and maybe make it a bit more saturated and maybe even change the color slightly more towards the turquoise here. rakwas, if you will. And that's pretty good. The only thing I don't like, however, is the problems with this, right? If I go to 100%, we have issues with skin. First, I don't like the color, and two, it is pulling out some noise. So I'll go to my sharpening, and let's see if we can reduce some of that noise by using some of these sliders and increase a bit more sharpening. Let's see, before and after, it smoothed out some of those details. I'm still kind of not too satisfied, but you know, it's better than nothing. And let's take a look now at the problem with her skin in terms of colors. So I'll go to my HSL slider, and maybe under oranges add slightly, because oranges are usually what you'll find in the skin tones. So I'll play around with this a bit, maybe make it like so, maybe reduce a bit on saturation, not too much, and on the luminance, maybe increase the luminance of that skin. And now, to make sure that I'm not doing everything bad, let's see, it's still not perfect. I to be quite honest, I don't really like it, so let's see if I can maybe make it a more creative effect by going to split toning, choosing the hue for highlights, maybe a bit more yellow. And for the background, let's go to reverse. Let's make it more, you know, another color. Maybe turquoise would work here, or these colors. Yeah, I like actually this one. Maybe try to find something that is going to look more interesting. I actually find this a bit more interesting, but I don't know, I think it's too much. So let's go back to the original and see if we can do with curves. I'll switch to my point curve, make an S curve just to increase the contrast a bit, then go to my red one and see what I can do here. If I add a bit of a cross processing to this image, maybe with curves we can get a better looking image. Yeah, I'm liking this one better. Not that much. Yeah, I actually like this. So I think it just made the image a bit more interesting, nothing too much. Maybe I'll go to blues and add some more, you know, warmth to this image. And yeah, I kind of like this. It's a nice starting point. And let's see if we can maybe see if there's some problems in terms of chromatic aberration. I think that's how you pronounce it. So let me zoom to the edges and see if there's any problem. Not too much, a bit here in the greens, right? So if I activate remove chromatic aberration, yeah, you see how it shifted, but not too much. So green amount, I'll increase that. If I can maybe remove it, yeah, that worked. See, watch the edges of the hair before and after. So I'm gonna just make sure I didn't touch anything else. Let's see if we have played around with something else here. No, I think we're fine. All right, so let's say this is the kind of look I'm going for. Actually, I think I might increase clarity a bit more because she is kind of not very sharp to begin with. And let's see if I can find something else. Actually, I like this one. Yeah, I kind of like this look. Let's see. All right, so I'll zoom one more time to about 100%. And let me show you a potential problem. So if I go to my sharpening or detail slider, you know, she is originally if I deactivate this, you can see that there's some detail in the texture and all that, but there's also some noise we pulled out when we brought back the shadows. So I want to make sure that I'm not introducing too much noise and leaving as much sharpness as I can. So I'm going to play around with these sliders a bit. Now, if this was a more close-up, more detailed shot, and I know I'm going to work on the skin, then typically this is where sharpening, I would turn it off completely, because the image would be sharp enough, so when I open it up inside of Photoshop, I have less to worry about in terms of texture to clone, heal, and do dodging and burning. But in this case, there isn't much texture to begin with, so any sharpening here would do good. You know, we want that. Okay, now that I'm done with that, I would select the other two images and click, shift select the other two images and click on synchronize. It will ask me, what do I want to synchronize? I want to go through everything. So it's going to open up. And here we have problems now, right? The minute I shifted to this one, it's problem with the skin a bit too much here. So if I go to my HSL sliders and I choose to go under luminance, here I want to go a bit darker because just the lighting isn't right. And under saturation, maybe even reduce that a bit. And under blues, reduce that a slightly. And under luminance, bring back some of that brightness, because it's not gonna look good. Here it looks better, but here it doesn't look good. There's too much difference between the way light falls, so it's not gonna look very natural. And I'm just gonna change a few small things. And the same is true here, right? There's just too much. Doesn't look good for this image. This would look much more natural, right? And the same is true if I reduce the blues here, actually something like this. Here, for example, we have a bit more blues, yellows, so I'll reduce the saturation of those yellows slightly. And let's see, compared to this one, yeah, a bit more saturated, so I'm gonna reduce that saturation here slightly. And let's go back and forth. Yeah, they're looking similar enough, right? So as you can see, not only can you match one image, but then you synchronize across the board, and then you're gonna have to probably adjust a few sliders here and there. But as long as you're in this user interface, this is pretty easy to do. And let's say that would be something I wanted to do. Now, let's say I'm done with this. I could now click open object and all that. Well, there are still a few things I wanted to check. Here under my workflow settings, I'm gonna make sure that my workflow settings are right. And what I'm gonna use here is probably for this, just like before. And in one of the videos in the future, I'll talk about why I chose this. Now I'll click OK for all these images, right? Now I could click open object and this will open all this inside of Photoshop as smart object. But when you think about it, you're not gonna work on a bunch of images all at once inside of Photoshop, right? But if you click done here, it's gonna go back into Bridge, but it also applied the adjustments. And now I can actually see that, on this last image, I could use a bit more saturation, in fact, which is great. So I'm gonna open them up once again. It's easier to see this inside of our Bridge than it is to see it inside of Camera Raw. So I'll just add a touch more saturation here, click done once again. It's gonna show them all side by side, and I think they're looking decent enough. The sky isn't looking great. Maybe on this one I made it, as you can see, a bit too, what's the color? A bit too turquoise, a bit too cyan. Maybe I wanted to make it more darker like we see here. So once again, I'll click on them and open in Camera Raw. Now this is a bit, it's not the best way to work, but unfortunately that's how you work inside of Camera Raw, at least I do. If you're in Lightroom, which I would prefer to be right now, this is an easier thing to do. So, just a food for thought. I'll make it like this. I think that will work better. I click done. It's gonna calculate everything, and now they're looking, I think, much better. Maybe make the sky in this one slightly slightly brighter. So what I'll do here is I'll go to my, again, HSL slider and make those skies slightly lighter, not too much, and click done. So, oops. And if I click that, now you can see they're matched a lot better. In fact, here maybe I could introduce a bit more saturation to the skin. Once again, I'll click on Open Camera Raw. And in this one, again, I'll click on my last image, go to my hue saturation, go into saturation, and just introduce a little bit more saturation in the skin. Click done. And now we have decent combination of images. They're very similar together, which is okay. And yeah, I think they're looking pretty decent. Now I will choose one of them, and let's say this one, or maybe let's start with this one actually. And I will click now on Open in Camera Raw once again. We'll open it up in Camera Raw, but this time I'm only using one image, right? So if I click Open Object, it's going to open it up inside of Photoshop. But now I only have one image in Photoshop because this is not where I'm matching color at the moment. I'm only preparing to, you know, retouch an image. So once I have this, I will click Use Embedded Profile. It's going to open it up. And we're ready to start working on this image. Now, this is what I would do now. I would continue to work just like I normally would, and I showed you, right? Once I'm done, then I would continue to add different elements to the image. Like color adjustments and everything, and then I would match them finally between them. Now you saw me use a bridge to go back from Camera Raw in order to observe the differences between the images. Now this is just something I personally like to do because it's easier for me to see the differences. However, if I wasn't recording for this, there's another view I like that really kind of takes care of all the clutter and shows me side-by-side images. And that's when you select the images, there's an option called here Refine, and then there is a Review mode or Control or Command B. You can use that. It will go full screen here, so I can't really show you, but you can try that at home. And what it does, it allows me to see the images without all the interface, everything, just the images side by side. When I'm viewing them inside of Camera Raw, especially when I was doing this on such a small screen that I'm recording on, it's difficult to see the differences really clearly. When I do it inside of Bridge, it is much easier to observe. That is why I do it, in case you were wondering. But let's say that I have now compared them. I have, as you saw me, synchronized them across the board. Well, now I can start editing the images. And here I have done, so you don't have to wait, I have done the classical stuff I normally do. And I showed you this in previous episodes, clean up and dodge and burn, right? Before and after. Before and after, just cleanup work, nothing much here to do. Same thing here, just cleanup work, a little bit of skin and stuff like in the background, nothing really major. So it was really quickly done. Once I have that, now in this relatively simple set of images, I would start actually doing some color correction. Now, there are things that I couldn't do properly inside of Camera Raw, or I didn't have the foresight to do them. Whatever the case, now I would like to do them. So one thing I like to do here is I would like to add some more contrast to this. So for example, I could go to my adjustments and maybe make a curve adjustment here, just typical S curve to add a bit of contrast. Yeah, I kind of like that. So if I had just one adjustment, something simple like this, then in order to shift that across the board, across all the other images, I would pick my move tool, make sure that my layer adjustment is selected, and then I would click on the image and drag and drop it here in order to transfer those adjustments. And I would do the same thing for this image. Now let's say I have a more complex adjustment. Perhaps I want to add here maybe something like black and white, and then set it to soft light. And now I can maybe manipulate this a little bit. And this gave me a lot of contrast, as you can see, but I'm losing a lot of details here in this particular case. I don't like the fact that I'm losing details in the shadows as much. So let's say I want to protect the shadows. Well, now I can use very easily the luminosity mask, if you remember. So I'll go to my channels, control or command click on the red channel. This will select everything that's 50% gray or lighter. I need to reverse that because I want to affect the shadows. So that's control shift I, and that's reverse. Click on the mask here and make sure that my black is in the background here, selected on my swatches. Then I'm going to click delete, and it's going to protect. It's going to create a very sophisticated but easy to create mask, which is going to protect those shadows. And this is what I got, right? Just a little bit of a punch to the image. Now, let's say I want to do the same thing on another image. Well, if I drag it like I would normally and I set it here, well, first of all, I see that my mask has been shifted and it's a mask from a different image, right? So that wouldn't work. Let me go back. By the way, if you want to drag and drop like this, but you want to make sure that it's aligned properly, then just hold down your shift key when you're dragging. This will make sure that it's always positioned at the center. Now, this is fine for the adjustment here that I have, but unfortunately, it's a different mask from a different image, right? So what I'll do is I'll delete this mask by alt dragging it into the trash can. And now with this still active, I'm gonna use this time a keyboard shortcut to do the same thing to select my luminosity mask. So that's control shift alt or command shift option and then two. And then control shift I to inverse. Make sure that my foreground is black here. And I'm gonna now alt or option click on the mask to immediately protect that. And here we go. We have a mask now which protects the image but gives it a little bit of contrast, right? Like we saw. And now I would drag that here, except again, I have to create another mask. So I'm going to repeat the process. Control shift alt 2, control shift E or I, and alt on the new icon for the mask. And here we go. I have protected that as well. And maybe it's a bit too much red in her skin, so maybe I want to add a little bit of more yellow to that. Well, that's fine. I'll create a new hue saturation. Click on this targeted adjustment tool, click somewhere on her skin, and maybe drag it slightly towards the right to give it more yellow. Maybe reduce the saturation a bit, like so. And there we go. Now I'm gonna grab my move tool again and drag it into the other image and the last one as well. And there we go. Now let's see. Now let's say that I've done something that's not good enough. Maybe now that I look at it, maybe it's a bit too yellow. Okay, fine, I can adjust that, right? Go to reds and maybe shift this to 2 instead of 5. I would do the same thing here. And the reason I'm showing you this is because this is how I would pretty much eyeball the differences between the images. And then by drag and dropping different adjustments, I would try to help myself in order to, you know, save me that one step. So let's merge this shift select and control or command G, call this color correction. I will just copy the name, do the same thing here, and copy the name, do the same thing here, copy the name, and there we go. So let's see the before and after. Before and after on this one. So before and after, and that's it. Let's say I'm satisfied with this, I would save it, and that would be the end of it. But as you can see, I have just moved it around left and right, and I helped myself by move, drag and dropping those adjustment layers, and that kind of speed up the process. But ultimately, I still have to perhaps tweak a little bit with my eyes, and this is a good thing to master, training your eye to spot the differences. And that's something we're going to talk about a bit more in the upcoming segment. So see you there. Okay, so now once I'm done editing those files, I would save them out as layered TIFFs. And let me just select those, and I would select them here and make sure that once again they're looking pretty much the same. If I see any inconsistency or something that I needed to fix, I can easily either open them up and change, or I can have them already open inside of Photoshop, and when I save, they should update the preview here. If the preview isn't updated, you can always right click on them and choose purge cache for selection. This will purge the cache and rebuild the thumbnail preview. Now, if that doesn't work, there's probably a bug, but it should always almost, if you don't see the inconsistency, just use purge cache for selection. That should fix it. Now, of course, we showed you with these images that it's really, really easy. And somebody asked me, do you use always multiple raw conversions? And as you can see here, I don't, because in this case, I didn't need to. It was a fairly simple image. But with the other images, these three, the situation was much more complex because we had more detailed image, more closer. There was something we tried to do to make it look like a Gucci ad. So there was more masking, more things involved. And once you do it with one image, you have to do it with multiple images to make the series look consistent. And that's what I wanted to talk about. So let's open up these images now inside of Photoshop. We'll start with this one. And as you can see, you already know this image probably by now, but as you know, we have different groups with different layers, and I started with different raw conversions. And then in the second image, the one I talked about in the previous episodes, I had one more group. And before I get into that, let me show you how I managed these different raw adjustments. Now, if you remember, I named them highlights, midtones, and shadows. Well, here's what you can do. You can, once you set in one image something, you can double click on this, or while you're working on it. And if you wanted to transfer this to another file, another project, you can go to this little icon and choose save settings. It will ask you which settings you want to save. I'll click save, and I will save it under some name as an XMP data. Now, of course, once I have that saved, and let's say I opened up in this image, I can transfer those same settings now, right? I just have to load settings this time and choose the appropriate setting. So that's how you can kind of move between different files and later without having them synchronized inside of Camera Raw. But here as layers, you can move around the settings. So that's what I used. And of course, the added thing that I had here with evening out the colors and tones is if I deactivate all of this and I just go to this point. Now, here's a very important thing I wanted to kind of stress out here is that typically what I'm looking for is a good solid foundation, a place where the color inside the image is under control as well as the tone, meaning that the color inside the skin tones is right, the color, the dynamic range in the image is right, or at least pretty decent, so I can start retouching and rebuilding on top of that. If I don't have that, I usually don't start. In order to build that, sometimes it's easier to use multiple raw conversions rather than trying to do it inside of Camera Raw right from the start. Sometimes you can, sometimes it's pain in the ass, so you want to do it where it's easier. For me, it was easier inside of Camera Raw. I had to use some masking here, but as I already mentioned, I think a few times, is that masking is really an important part of you being a retoucher. It's like knowing how to use masks is retouching with a sniper versus retouching with a shotgun. Okay, it allows you very precise edits anywhere you want, but they're easy to create, easy to manipulate, easy to copy and paste to another image. So you should really pay attention to masking. If masking is not your thing and you're trying to learn, and there is an episode, I think episode number 5 in this series, where I talk about that. And if this is not enough, if you want to learn more about masking, this is the time. Leave me some comments in the comment section. And if there's enough interest, I'll create a video specifically on masking. So, but if that's not enough, sometimes I would have to use other tools inside of Photoshop. Again, with masking, this would be adjustment layers. And I would use this in order to, as you can look at the image, to achieve more even color and tone. bring everything under control, and then I would retouch the image and add some color correction at the end to match this one. Okay, now I'm gonna close these two images because we want to focus on the third image, and that will be this one. Now the thing with this image is, first I thought, you know, you already saw me do the other two, so this new one will not only show you the same process with few additional things, but also there are some things inside this image that will allow me to show you new things that you haven't seen yet. I'm running out of time here a bit, but I'll make this a longer episode then. What the hell? Okay, so what I wanted to show you here is that, like before, I have, if you ignore this layer, I have multiple raw conversions, evening out the color and tone, clean up and dodge and burn and color correction, just like I would in other, in other images that I showed you. Now, of course, let me just go back here and show you the multiple raw conversions. It's fairly simple. Once you know how to use the masks, and I think I showed you, it's pretty easy. The biggest time-consuming part of this image, which actually took about 6-7 minutes, was selecting the actual model, both models, right? Once you have that, pretty much everything else is easy to manipulate, both foreground and background. So again, I had my shadows adjustment, then I had one for the midtones with a mask, and then one for the highlights. Now, once I had that, I saw that this image has some problems. There is inconsistency in color, and again, I'm trying to get that foundation right, where color is in a realistic manner or some natural matter is consistent across the image. And by color, I mean skin tones primarily. So if I activate my evening out the color and tone layer, you can see what I did. Now, the fact that I made them more yellow and all that, that's something I'm not worried about because I'm going to change that at the end anyway. What I really want looking for is just consistency, so that the tone and color is pretty much consistent throughout the image. I don't have, you know, red parts of the image and you know, red nose like Rudolph or something versus you know, greenish tint here or something like that. So real quick, let me show you what I did. So here I did something, you know, I just selected loosely the leg with a quick selection tool, and I used curves here to change the color slightly and to make it a bit darker. So now it matches a bit more the rest of his the rest of the image, right? Now, as you will see me use a lot of these adjustments, but I don't use numbers or something like that. It's all done by eye. And personally, that's how I like to work, and that's what I would recommend. It's going to take more time for you to develop eyes for these kind of things, but I would highly recommend you spend time in developing your eyes for this kind of thing. The reason why it's a good idea is, in my opinion, is because it's more flexible than using numbers. It is easier to adjust things with when you see problem and you know how tools work. You can do it in any program. If you're using just numbers, sometimes you're dependent on the tools that allow you to use numbers. So if you are really good with your eyes and you know the tools, there's nothing you can fix really easily and quickly. So that's what I would recommend. Now here's was another thing, and here what I wanted to show you with when time comes time to fixing certain problems within the image. So here we had an issue with his nose being a bit more red, right? Well, let me show you something. I'll activate my just for demonstration purposes, my color wheel here, and I'll grab a hue saturation. I'll clip it to this tool, so I only affect that. Now you can see something how this tool works, right? If I move it left and right, I'm basically remapping the colors within the color wheel. And if you look at here at the bottom, what you'll see is that we have two strips, which is basically the color wheel flat out on in 2D, and you know, like strip, and the upper strip always remains the same. That shows you what the colors are when you open up the tool, and the colors at the bottom basically are going to shift as I move the sliders. So what it tells you is the relationship between what once were and what it is now. So if I move this to the left, you can see that what was once red is going to now be blue, right? And if I show you an actual image, let me do that. And here we go. What was once orange, their skin tones are no longer orange, they are now pink. just like we can see the difference, right? And if I move this all the way to the blue, you can see that the orange skin, what used to be orange, is now blue. And in fact, if you look at the image, it is pretty much blue or pink, actually purple in this case. So that's how it works. And if I wanted to change a certain color within the image, well, I can use this target adjustment tool. I can click on it and I can click on, let's say, blue. And now it's going to select among the presets blue. And if I change that, I'm only changing the blue, nothing else. But of course, if I wanted to change more of the blue, maybe target cyans as well, but not the rest of the wheel, I can actually change these little things here, this handles. And this comes really useful because you have these two handles, one here and one here. That decides what color range have I just selected. And these two other ones, they decide how much of a fall off will be. What's the feather of the selection? So we want more of the cyans, right? So I'm going to move this slider a bit towards here. And I'm going to move this slider here and this one here. And let's see, when I change it, you can see that I'm changing blues as well as those cyans now, but not the greens, not the oranges and all that. So that's how the tool works. So let me deactivate this one and let me show you on an actual image. Now we have a problem here, and that's that we have certain parts of the skin which are going to be more red. This is a common situation with skin, especially under certain lighting, with certain models. You get this really red specks on the skin, if you ever saw that, and it's sometimes a problem to fix. Well, with this tool, it becomes usually an easy thing to fix. And maybe I can show you here. You see this area, it's more of an orange area, but let me find something where we have discoloration issue. Maybe his nose, for example, which is going to be more red than the rest of the face. So what I'll do is I'll click on my targeted adjustment tool. I will click somewhere on his nose. It's going to select the next best thing. That's going to be reds here. So what I'll do is I'll exaggerate the effect here. I will make this all the way to the right. And what you'll see is sort of a breakup between different tones, right? So it's kind of certain colors will change differently. This gives us an idea that definitely there is certain color in the nose, but around the nose in here, there is a different color. So I'll exaggerate this so I can actually see what I'm doing. And now I know I'm targeting more red, less yellow, right? So I'm going to use those tools here to be precise at what I'm selecting. And you can see what I'm selecting here very well, right? There we go. See how precise I can now select just those reds. There were some reds here and here. And now I'm going to reset the tool here by double clicking on it. Now it's going to get back to normal. Now when I move this to the right, I'm going to add more yellow to those red areas. Now watch the image as I move this to the right. See? Let me show you before and after. Before, ignore the lips here, just focus on this area. After, before and after. Very even now for the color, right? Maybe I can add a bit more, because that was in the shadows, so maybe I can add a bit more saturation here. Now let's see, before and after, perfect. But of course, I have an issue with the lips. I have changed everything inside the image, and this of course affected areas like this here. But unfortunately, the lips are also affected. If you have similar colors, maybe a fabric that she's wearing or blue hair, and you're selecting the skin, you might run into this problem. That's why the masking is something we can use. So I'm going to grab my black brush and just paint over the areas where there are lips. And this gives me a relatively quick fix for the sake of color correction, evening out the tone. Right, so that's exactly what I did here. I don't think we need this anymore. That's what I did here with this tool. And then I just mask out the lips. And then here I just made a loose selection and maybe add a bit of contrast here for certain elements in the image. Here I made some of the shadows a bit darker. Again, loose mask. But remember, once I have the mask for the model and everything, it's easy to reselect it and use it again. So that's, once you have that mask, everything else is loosely painted on top of that selection. And here I made a slight adjustment. Maybe I shouldn't, but I just made the her highlights and stuff slightly more brighter, that's it. And then I added a color layer here for this area to kind of make it more of the same color. And now when I deactivate the evening out of color and tone, we have much more even image, as you can see here, right? So that's how I would have to use my eyes to see the difference and change that before I even go to actual color correction of the image. And this is a very common situation that you will have to first even out the colors. Some areas will be darker, some will be brighter, some will be, skin complexion will be different. There will be a color bounce, light bouncing off something and creating a color cast on parts of the image. All these problems is something that you may have to fix before you even get to color correction. And the best thing to do is to train your eyes so you can start doing that. Once you train your eyes, it becomes much, much easier. And there's no shortcut for that. It's just like anything else, training, right? So you're gonna have to train your eyes. Thank you for watching, and if you see any videos that you like on my channel, please give me a thumbs up, click the like button, share it if you like with your friends, spread the word, leave a comment, give me some feedback so I can make better videos. And if you like to receive more videos that I upload and get a up-to-date state on my channel and the tutorials I make, please click on the subscribe button. And here's a really interesting thing I would also recommend. You see this little icon here, this little wheel? If you click on it, there's an option called Send Me Updates, and you click just Save. That way you will get updates to your directly to your inbox in your email, not just on the channel update, and you will never miss a video. Thank you for watching, and see you in the next one.